English Lecture Series. I'm Karen Matthews of University Video Communications. Our program is designed to enrich graduate and upper division curricula with academic presentations by top computer scientists from industry. Its speakers and topics were nominated by computer science faculty of more than 50 universities. This presentation is sponsored by IBM University Relations. Dr. John Backus, a respected leader in computer science, led the group that designed Fortran. He was also a designer of ALGOL and BNF. He received the ACM Turing Award and the National Medal of Science. His research interests are function-level programming and algebraic program transformation. His talk today is function-level programming and the FL language. It's our pleasure to introduce Dr. John Backus. John?
Thank you, Karen. So this is the title of my talk and also an outline of it. That is, I'm going to be talking about function-level programming for a while, and then I'm going to describe a new experimental language we call FL that tries to exploit the function-level style of programming. These are the names of my friends, John Williams and Ed Wimmers, who have worked with me on developing all of this. This is a report that you can get about FL by writing to any one of us at this address. So the question is, what is function-level programming? Well, it's a style of programming that regards programs as just functions. And it has the following properties. It is, first of all, referentially transparent, which means that if I have two expressions, P and Q, that denote the same function, then I can replace in some larger program, F of P, I can replace every occurrence of P by Q and not change the meaning of the whole program. Secondly, it is a function-level style of programming. And to explain that, I have to tell you what I mean by object-level programming. We're given two functions, G and H, and we want to define a new function, F. Now, in this style of programming, we do something very peculiar. We begin by picking what we call an arbitrary object, which we choose to call X, and we start building objects. We apply the function H to X to get H of X, and then we apply G to that. And we say, this is the result I want to have for F of X. And so we make this equality. And in order to define the actual function itself, we have to sort of get rid of X now. And we do that by either waving our hands and saying, well, this has got to be true for all X, or we use lambda abstraction and limit and abstract away the variable X. But the point is here that we're writing equations between objects. We're saying this object is the same as this object. And that seems like a very strange thing to be doing when we're trying to define programs. This style of programming is the accepted style of programming that you're all familiar with and love. And it's the style of programming that's used in Lisp and in most functional languages, and it's also used in conventional languages. But now let's contrast that style of defining a function with the function-level style. Here we're given the same two functions, G and H, and we want to define F again. So we simply form the function that we want by applying the operator composition to the functions g and h. And so we can write this equation between two functions, which says that f is the function g composed with h. And that style, I think, is much more appropriate for dealing with programming. Function-level programming consists of building new functions with combining forms. And let me give you a little example of how you might define inner product. Here we've defined it, and it is built from three primitive functions, plus, times, and transpose, using two combining forms, composition, which we've already seen, and apply to all, which is a new combining form that I can apply to times to get a new function, and we'll see how that works in a second. So if we apply this inner product function to a pair of vectors, what will happen? Well, the very first thing that we need to do in applying a define function is to substitute the definition for the function, for the function name, which we've done here. And now our task is to simply apply these three functions in succession. Applying transpose to the argument, which is a pair of triples, gives a triple of pairs, as shown. Then applying apply to all of times to that results in times being applied to each pair. Evaluating those products gives us three numbers, which we can then add up to get the value of the inner product. So you might ask, why function level? Why do we insist on this unfamiliar style of programming that when you're all familiar with a different one? And the answer is that, well, in the first place, it's the right way to program. And if you're talking about programs, you should be talking about building programs, not about putting objects together. And the main purpose of it is to make programming an engineering discipline. And we think that these are the components that are required to have a programming engineering discipline. First of all, programs have to be structured. If you want to put these existing programs indicated by these little squares together to form a new program, you want to build it up successively using combining forms to build these new programs and then put those together with this thing, finally to build the program you want so that it has a regular structure with clearly defined parts. A second element is that it requires a set of off-the-shelf programs that have been carefully constructed to be standard programs so that most of the work of constructing a new program has been done for you, so that when you start writing a program, you simply find the standard programs that you need, write a few more little things, and put it together and get a program. And that is not possible in conventional programming, hardly at all, whereas engineers do this all the time. They build circuits with standard circuits. They don't always go off and build new little circuits to construct a bigger one. They work with standard circuits. It is also important to have programs put together so that when you put some known programs together with an operation to combine them into a new program, that if you understand the programs you start with, you understand in a very simple and direct way the program that results from putting them together. That is a property that is missing in conventional programming. The operation while, for example, lacks this property very, very much. And it makes understanding conventional programs very difficult, and that property is lacking. And finally, and perhaps most important of all, we need to have a general body of applicable knowledge that you can apply very easily, not just methodology, but equations that give you results by simply substituting into those equations. You get either a fact about a program or you get a program directly. So that we can use this accumulated knowledge to very easily prove things about programs or to transform them. And that is another important property in an engineering discipline, that you should be able to write a correct program and use equational knowledge to transform it into a fast program so that you don't have to worry all the time about efficiency while you're doing that. So now I'd like to tell you about combining forms that we use in this style. Composition, we've already seen, just simply means F composed with G means first apply G and then apply F to the result of G. Construction is a unusual but very important combining form that combines any number of programs to build a new program such that when I apply that to some object, I get the set of all the results so that applying F1 to Fn, the construction of that to X, gives simply the sequence of F1 of X through Fn of X. recommendation is a combining form that combines three functions. And when you apply it to x, you get f of x if p of x evaluates to true, g of x if p of x evaluates to false, and the error otherwise. Now we have a number of combining forms that build predicates from existing predicates, and this is one of them. Predicate construction combines n predicates to form, indicated by these double square brackets. It combines those to form a new predicate such that it will be true for any object that has n elements in it, any sequence of length n, for which each p is true for the corresponding x. So, for example, here is a predicate that's been constructed by using this operation twice, and it will produce a predicate that is true for sequences whose first member is a pair of integers and whose second member is a character. So this predicate will be true for objects of this kind. Now I think it's instructive to look at a recursively defined function. Here is a definition of the function length, which computes the length of any sequence. And I think the easiest way to look at it is to just see what happens when we apply it to a sequence of length 4. A sequence containing just 4. Again, the first thing that we have to do when applying a defined function is replace it by its definition. So here we've done that, and now we have to apply this predicate to the argument, and we find that isNull of the sequence 4 is false. So we have to apply the second arm of the condition to proceed. Here it is, and that involves applying this construction to the sequence 4, which means applying both these functions to that argument, which we've done here. The tilde indicates a constant valued function, so this function will give 1 no matter what you apply it to. So this is the constant 1 function. And we have to apply this. So evaluating these two things gives us 1, and the tail of 4 of the sequence 4 is the empty sequence. So we find ourselves again evaluating the length of something. And so again we have to replace it by its definition and proceed. Doing that, we now find that isNull of the empty sequence is true, and therefore we have to apply the first arm of the condition, which is the constant 0 function. Doing that gives 0, and we wind up with 1 as the length of this sequence. Now it's interesting to note that in this function level style, you can define the same function in a non-recursive way. And if we define length to be plus composed with the apply to all of the constant 1 function, then applying that to this sequence of length 3, we get replacing length by its new definition. Then doing apply to all of the constant 1 function results in the constant 1 function applied to each element. Each of these evaluates to 1. Adding it up gives the length of the sequence. Now, this kind of function is a lot easier to reason about than a recursively defined function. So it's nice, it's easy to think about them and to prove things about them, so it's nice to use this style when you can. Now, to reason about programs, it's important to have, or certainly convenient to have, a large number of laws that allow you to transform programs in a very general way that depends only on their structure and not on the ingredients from which they're built. So that, of the various laws that one can have, this kind of law, which is what I call a symmetric law, is extremely important let's look at this example. This is a law that says a program built with composition that involves construction can be expressed as a program that is built with construction and involves composition. So that the importance of these symmetric laws is that they allow you to change the main connective of a program or a piece of program. That enables you to make big transformations in programs. Now, the interesting thing about the combining forms that we've chosen is that every pair of them has at least one law associated with it, so that I can change between any, from composition to construction, from composition to condition, and between condition and construction. And also, here's a law that involves apply to all construction and composition. So these laws are extremely useful and very basic laws in the algebra of programs. Here are three more laws which I will use in the example that follows immediately. And it suffices just to observe that this first law allows you to move and apply to all of the functions in past and append left in side here. So that whenever I'm doing apply to all of a sequence that's been constructed by appending something onto an existing sequence, I can transform this expression into that. The second law says that a constant valued function, when composed with any function, is just a constant valued function, provided this law works only in the domain for which f is defined. And the third law allows us to simply get rid of an append left when we're summing up a sequence that's built by append left to give us that expression. So using those laws, we can now prove a simple theorem by using equational algebraic reasoning. This little proposition says that the length of a sequence that's built by appending the result of F onto the sequence produced by G is the same as 1 plus the length of the sequence produced by G. And this proposition is going to hold in the domain for which F is defined. So how do we prove that? Well, we simply start with the left side of the proposition here. Replace length by its definition, by its non-recursive definition, plus composed with apply to all of constant 1. And then we notice that the part underlined in green is the left side of the law that allows us to move an apply to all past an append left. And when we do that, when we use that law, that is, we replace the instance of this side by the right side of that same law, we get this expression. Now that we've done that, we notice that here is a case of a constant valued function composed with f, and that law says that if f is defined, then we can get rid of f. And since the proposition assures us that it is defined, we can get rid of f and get this expression. Then we see that we've got an instance of the law that allows us to get rid of an append left when we're adding things up. And using that law, we get this expression. And now we notice that this part of the expression is just the definition of length, so that we can replace that by length. And we have arrived at the right-hand side of the proposition that we were trying to prove, and so we proved it. So that's about all the time I can devote to talking about functional-level programming. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about the experimental language that we're designing to exploit this style of programming. First, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the design goals that we've taken for the language. And I have to say that they're extremely difficult goals, and we're completely uncertain as to what degree we'll be able to reach them. But we think that it's worth trying, that we'll learn a lot, at least in the effort. So the first goal we want for the language is that it should be a very broad scope language, that it should be capable of writing virtually any program whatsoever, including the ones I've listed here, or database programs, or any program you can essentially think of. You should be able to write it in FL. The second goal is that we want it to make a really large change in the cost of programming, hopefully to reduce the cost of programming by a factor of 10 or more. To do that, of course, we need to depend very much on the use of carefully designed off-the-shelf programs that that form the basis for writing any program that you want to use or to write. And we think that the fact that FL programs can be considerably more general than conventional programs will add to the possibility of reusing programs that are written to be reused, of course. We don't intend to reuse everybody's program. Another factor that will help this, we believe, is that it's harder to be concerned about efficiency when you're writing an FL program. Many of them are very inefficient, in fact. And since in writing a conventional program, you devote an awful lot of effort to worrying about efficiency and trying to make your program efficient, we feel that this will make programming a lot less expensive because you won't be doing that. So now, if we can achieve the first two goals to some fairly good degree, the last goal is then probably the hardest one to meet, because we're dealing with a very rich language, a very powerful language. The problem of producing very fast-running programs from it, so that when you've written an FL program, you get a program that you can really use, not just a prototype that you then have to later reprogram in C. One of the problems that we face is that when you write a number-crunching program in FL, we expect to produce the kind of code that a good Fortran compiler would produce for that program. And if you write a list processing program, we would expect to produce the kind of program that a good Lisp compiler would produce, or at least one that runs as fast. And we base our hopes for doing this on the fact that we have this powerful mathematics of programs. That's why we keep insisting on this style of programming, so that we can do algebraic optimization over transform programs over large distances, if you will. There are a number of novel FL properties of the language, that support these design goals. Of course, the first of them is that it is function level, and I've sort of discussed why it should contribute to making programming cheaper and producing fast programs. FL programs have a very unusual functionality that is designed to make it possible to do input-output and treat with permanent files in your programs. This problem of how to deal with I/O and permanent files has always been a difficult problem to incorporate in a functional language. And there are many different approaches, and I will talk about this a bit more at length later. But the basic functionality of a program is that it maps pairs, values, and histories into other such pairs. And we believe that this will make it possible and easy to write interactive programs and systems programs. And finally, we have an unusual approach to types in FL, in that we have provided hierarchical basic types and provisions for defining using defined types. But we've done that in a very kind of laid-back way that makes it possible to write typed programs, but without having a great intrusion into the programming process of the typing business. Before I talk about our approach to input-output, I'd like to explain why we have not adopted the approach that several functional languages have taken to this problem, and that is the pure functional approach. In this approach, input from a given device like the keyboard is regarded as a potentially infinite stream, but a single entity, which is to be an argument of an interactive program. So that, for example, if I if I have an interactive editor, it would take in such a stream from the keyboard. All the data that will ever come from the keyboard is in this object that, that the editor gets, so it's potentially infinite. And it also takes in the document to be edited, and it produces the keyboard, the rest of the keyboard stream that it doesn't consume in interacting with the user. It produces the edited document, and it produces a stream of data to be displayed on the screen, like the document that's being edited. So that typically interactive programs that deal with a keyboard and screen have this two input, three output functionality. And when you wish to compose two such programs, you have to put them together as I've illustrated in this picture. It's pretty straightforward as regards the keyboard and document part of the putting together. But in order to make a sensible putting together of the screen streams, you have to concatenate this, the data coming from the editor so that it comes out before the screen data coming from the formatter. So that having put these two programs, editor and an interactive formatter, together, we have formed a new two into three composite program. And that is a form of composition for interactive programs. Now, that kind of composition doesn't have such good mathematical properties as the composition we saw earlier, the basic composition. And of course, secondly, it is another kind of composition, so that in such a system, you have to have a composition operator for interactive programs and a different composition operator for ordinary programs. Another problem with this approach is that if you wish to deal with more devices than just the keyboard and the screen, this functionality gets much more complicated. And if you wish to deal with permanent files, it gets impossibly complicated. So that's what we have not adopted. What we have done is to sort of declare that all programs are going to map values and histories into a new value and a new history, where a history is a chronological record of all the events of all the input-output devices and of transactions with the file system. So that in the formal view, we view programs as having this functionality, but of course, informally, you can view a program in a context given by some history as simply mapping a value into a new value, with the side effect, possibly, of altering the history that it started with. So, for example, if we look at the primitive function tail, in the formal view, it maps a sequence and history into the tail of that sequence and the same history. Informally, we would view it as just mapping the sequence into its tail, with no side effect. Now, almost all the primitives of FL are of this type. That is, they neither depend on nor change the history. So that the informal view of them is really a complete story. However, there are a very small number of primitives that are very important that do change the history. For example, in, when given a device name and a history, produces the input from that device and a new history. In the informal view, simply in applied to a device name produces the input from that device. And it changes the history in such a way that when I apply in to that same device name again, I will get the next input, not the one I got before. So that, for example, if I build a construction of in and apply that to some device name. That requires applying in to device name twice, and those applications will be evaluated from left to right, so that this end will produce an input from the device, and this end will produce another input from that device, and that will be the result of that. So that's our basic approach to input-output. And I'd like to just outline what the benefits of this approach are. First of all, it stresses the purpose of a program and hides its interaction as side effects. So that, for example, if I have an interactive editor, in the informal view, I can view it as simply mapping a document into an edited document. And the interaction here is just a side effect. So that in more detail, if I apply this editor as a function to that document, nothing will happen until, except interaction with the user, until the user presses a key that says he's finished editing the document, in which case the value of editor applied to document will be the edited document. This view also allows you now to change this editor can be altered to interact, say, with a file system to get other edited documents up in the process of doing its editing. And that will not change this basic functionality. That will just be a change in how it interacts with the system. Secondly, this approach allows us to use strict semantics, that is, bottom-up semantics. And that kind of semantics is much more simple and easy to understand than lazy semantics, which is required in the pure approach. Third, in this approach, you have no synchronization problems. Everything is sort of ordered. Every I/O event has a definite order, and it's very apparent what that order is from the program. In the pure approach, in lazy semantics, it's very hard to assure that something you want to happen before something else actually will do that. And people who write lazy programs are often very surprised by what happens. And finally, it enables us to handle many devices and a file system without complicating the functionality of the programs that you write. And that's a very important property. In a real system that has to communicate with not just a keyboard and a string, but has to have a file system and many other devices that it can use. So the basic result of this choice that we've made is that it trades generality for convenience. That is, there are some issues in the pure approach that are actually easier to do things. Once you've paid all the price of the complicated functionality, you can, for example, replace a device by a program very easily in the pure approach. In our approach, it is not as easy, but we do plan to have facilities for user-defined device drivers. Here's a little example of an interactive program that called Prompt. What Prompt does, if you apply it to a string, it will display that string on the screen, and then it will return as its value the value of the key that you press in response to that displayed message. So here's its definition, and to see how it works, we'll apply it to this string enter number, and doing that requires us now to first apply this construction to enter number. Applying the constant screen function to that gives screen. Applying the identity function to enter number gives enter number. So that we find ourselves now applying the function out to the pair screen enter number. And that simply displays enter number on the screen as a side effect, and it returns its argument as its value, so that here we've done out. All it does is have this side effect of displaying a message. And now we're evaluating constant keyboard applied to this thing. We'll constant keyboard applied to anything gives keyboard, so that we're now down to evaluating in applied to keyboard. But of course, by the time this is evaluated, the message enter keyboard has already appeared on the screen, so that what will come in here will be the response, the key press, that results from that message, so that it really can be seen to do what we claimed. Now I'd like to just briefly discuss a couple of features of FL that make it expressive and make it easy to write programs. One of our most important constructs for that purpose we call patterns. Patterns are built with predicate combining forms, and they denote a predicate. This particular example of a pattern denotes a predicate that will be true for objects of this shape, that is, objects of its own shape, with the only proviso being here that z here must be an integer to pass this predicate, because we have specified that things in this position of the pattern must be integers. But patterns do more than specify a predicate. They also define some functions. They define, in this case, x, y, and z, which are the fact that these are definitions is indicated by the fact that they have periods after them. And the functions that they define will select elements in the position that the function name occupies. So that this x, the function defined by this x, will select an x from this position. Y will select a y from that position. Z will select that. So to sum up, a pattern has a predicate associated with it that is very simply related to the pattern itself, and it defines some functions which select things that are in the position that they are in. So that now patterns can only be used in the predicate position of a condition, and here and the scope of the definitions that they make only apply to the two arms of that condition. So here is a one-armed condition, which is a perfectly legitimate construct in this language, which the pattern specifies that it be true for a pair, any pair at all, and it defines x so that it will select the first element of the pair, and y so that will select the second. So this construction now says, put the first element of the pair in the second position and put the second element in the first position. So the result of this condition is that it will be defined for pairs and it will reverse the pair. Another feature that we have put in is allow you to write infix notation at the function level. So that if I write, for example, f append left prime g in this order, that results in this function. The net effect of it is that if I apply this to some x, I will get append left applied to f of x and g of x. And finally, we have the facility to write local definitions. Anywhere in an expression, you can write a where clause, and those can have a number of definitions in them, and they can hide definitions or export definitions as you want. So, to really, you know, there's lots of things I haven't been able to tell you about FL, but I want to conclude by just summarizing the optimization problems that we face. It is really an extremely difficult problem, and we don't know it. There's a lot we do not know about how we're going to deal with it, but I'd like to indicate the sort of plan that we have in mind at present. First of all, we plan to extend FL by adding a number of constructs to given in large language, EFL. The constructs that we add are required to have the property that they be purely functional constructs, and second, that they correspond very obviously to an efficient machine language program, so that it's possible to write in EFL a program that is clearly efficient, that you can translate locally, bit by bit, into machine code and feel that it's really efficient. So having done that, we then have this sort of super optimization problem, which consists of taking very simple and very likely very inefficient FL programs of a great variety and turn those in some automatic way into probably very complex but very efficient EFL programs. That's really a mind-boggling task to do very well. Of course, after we get an efficient EFL program, there's still a problem of code generation, but that's generally a well-understood problem that we're not concerned with at this point. So to do this, we need to develop a lot of complicated algebraic rewrite strategies using the algebraic laws and a lot of other heuristic principles that will be needed to transform a program in EFL into a very efficient program in EFL. And one of the problems that's going to cause us a lot of difficulty is this necessity of mixing two programming styles. One, the Fortran programming style in which data is stored in a compact way and is addressed directly by using indexing. And the other style of programming used for list processing that stores data as list structures and uses pointers. And the problem of getting those two things to work together effectively and cleanly is a difficult one. So that's about all I have time, I'm afraid, to tell you about FL. I hope you'll get a manual and take a look at it. Let us know how you feel about it. Thank you.
I'm Judith Lemon from University Video Communications, and our first question is from the University of Utah. John, what about writing concurrent programs in FL?
Well, at present we have no facilities in FL for writing such programs, but we do plan to extend the language in the future to handle writing systems programs that require one program to run a number of other programs, but we have done none of that at present.
Another question from the University of Utah. What are the advantages from the point of view of rapid prototyping?
Well, I hope the advantage is that you write programs rapidly, but they won't be prototype programs. They'll run very fast, and they'll be the final programs that you won't have to rewrite it and see.
And from the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, will we ever see device drivers in FL?
We are working on provisions for device drivers that will allow the user to write a program and associate that program with a given device so that it will alter the input from the device or perhaps simulate it entirely.
Thank you. Okay. And our last question, can you comment on failure?
Well, that's a subject that's interested me a lot because I've seen so many young people in our culture today that emphasizes success all the time and is always pointing to the success of researchers in developing some wonderful new thing. This pressure to succeed, I've found, has caused many young students who I thought would make a very good researcher to start doing research and then finding that they fail again and again and again and become very discouraged very rapidly because the media creates the impression that they should succeed right away. And so they leave research, and I think this is a great shame that that young people have to understand that research is 90% failure. It's very painful to the ego to fail again and again and again. I know I've done an awful lot of failing in my career, and I think that young students should recognize that that's what research is about. And if they can't stand failing, then don't try to do research. But it can be born.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you. We invite your comments and questions on this presentation, and we hope you will make nominations for future speakers and topics. If you're viewing us on tape, there is a feedback postcard under the video cassette label of your tape. And if you're not viewing us on tape, our address is at the end of the credits. Thank you again.